this section, we're going to talk about some of the key concepts related to security in TM1. The first one to understand is that, like many tools, security is not applied in TM1 to a user. Users are never secured for particular actions or objects or anything like that. Users are made members of groups. It is groups that we assign security to. We can apply security to these groups by object and privilege. The objects I can secure are cubes, dimensions, elements, cube cells, processes, and chores. The privileges I can grant these objects determine what members of the group I'm securing can actually do. There's 6 types of privileges, although you may only use a few of these. So none is fairly self-explanatory. Users can't see or modify the object at all. Read, also pretty straightforward. Users can see the object, but they can't change it. Write is read security implied, so you never have to grant read and write. Read, but with also the ability to edit the object. Reserve is a bit less commonly used, but it's effectively write with the added ability to reserve the object for exclusive access, so no other users can access that object while that user is working with it. Lock prevents anyone, including the user who actually locked the object, from performing any edits. Only a group with admin permissions can unlock the object for edit. Reserve and lock are more commonly associated with data objects, so cubes, elements, cells, rather than the maintenance objects like dimensions, processes, and chores, although of course these can be used with any of the objects. Finally, admin is also very self-explanatory. This includes all permissions. There is nothing members with admin permissions can be prevented from doing to an object. So just to review, we understand that groups are secured. They're secured for objects by privileges, so everyone gets a set of privileges for each object that they're secured for. But let's back up for a second and think about 2 other important things. And we'll start with the group user paradigm. So we talked about users being members of groups. Groups are where we apply our security, but a user can be a member of more than one group. So what happens if I'm a user who's a member of a group that has no permissions or has a none permission set for an object, but I'm also a member of a group that has write permission for an object? Which wins? And the answer is that with TM1, where users and groups are concerned, it is the least restrictive policy that gets applied. So effectively, if any of the groups that you are a member of has elevated permissions to an object, it's that permission that will be used. It may sound like that's a very open policy for security, but in fact, it is the reverse, because it allows you to be so specific with permissions and to grant things at a higher level, easing maintenance. So for example, if I have a salary planning application with a number of cubes that I know users will need access to, perhaps a set of merit assumptions by grade or something like that, I know everyone needs to see these, but only one user needs to edit them, I can very easily define 2 groups, one with the greater set of permissions for read on all the objects we need access to, but then one very specific one for users who need to update those assumptions. Some other key basics to know are that, while we've been talking about how we secure objects that have been created, when it comes to dimensions, cubes, processes, and chores, only members of the system-generated groups, admin and data admin, are ever permitted to create those. If you have a specific need for other groups to create these objects, without granting users of those groups the more godlike privileges associated with admin and data admin groups, you can create processes or chores to do this, and then grant those groups permission to the process or chore. Note that the cases for this will be very rare, and you should really consider the need very carefully first. So, only admin and data admin groups and members of those groups are creating cubes, dimensions, processes, and chores. But in addition to that, the defaults for those objects are similar in that only data admin and admin can access those objects. The default access level is none for each of those. For elements within a dimension, it gets a little bit different. So by default, with no security applied to a dimension, the default access level for elements is actually write. Now this saves you the trouble of securing every single element that you create or anything like that, or trying to manage that problem. By default, they're just write level. But as soon as you secure a dimension, you say that this dimension requires element security because you don't want everyone to see everything, then the default access level becomes none. So that's for new groups, also for new elements added to that dimension. So if, for example, I have two dimensions, a cost center dimension, which I want secured for specific groups that should have access to that cost center's data, and I also have a currency dimension, which isn't secured at all. If I add a new cost center, I have to secure that dimension for anyone to see it. Their default access for every group will be none, except of course for our admin and data admin groups. But for a new currency, because I haven't defined security, element security on that dimension, they will be able to see any new currencies that I add. And one last comment on how this object security works is that because a chore is just a collection of processes, when you grant a group access to run a chore, their individual security permissions for the processes that make up that chore are just ignored. They can still execute that chore. All processes within that chore will run, regardless of a group's specific permissions on a given process. So in this video, we've covered the rules and the concepts around how security works in TM1. But if you really want to get your hands dirty, I suggest you check out any of the links that point you to the mechanics of creating security. So actually adding groups, adding users to groups, connecting to your corporate LDAP, using Cognos 10 authentication, all that sort of thing. Because while the theory is great, it's only the practical application of what you've learned here that will actually be useful. So good luck and thanks for your time.